Professor Saikia is well known, but still I will say few words. After studying with Professor John Coates, Professor Saikia settled in IIT Guwahati, and there he has developed a very wonderful group. Yesterday in a couple of talks, we saw some clips of that group. And Professor Saikia is a very, very popular speaker. Actually, I think it was 9 years back, I heard one talk on congruent number problem. And I really liked it. In fact, I will love to see if I can do something with you in that work. And also many of his students, apart from this IIT Guwahati group, many of his students have spread out around the country. And one student is working with me as well. So on the other side, Professor Saikia is very good in many games. Actually, I was seeing his profile and I knew only about badminton and cricket, but then it seems that he's good in many, many games. But badminton, I have seen him playing badminton. He's very good at that. And today's talk will be on congruent numbers and their generalization. So Anupam da, to you.
Thank you, Prem, for your kind words. And it's a great pleasure to be a part of this wonderful conference. I participated in all the three previous editions, and so I thank Kailan and Adhisul, Prem, Mohit, and Rishabh, and all others. I don't know all the names, but I'm sure new people have been like helping Kailan in organizing this. So, and thanks for the invitation as well as for keeping it going all these years. And this year's edition is, of course, very special because we are celebrating the 75th birth year of Professor Mitchell. And as Kailan has very aptly said yesterday, that Professor Mitchell is very dear to us, not only for his immense contribution to mathematics, but also for being an ambassador and for being a source of inspiration for so many of us. And he has visited so many places in India. I think many Indian mathematicians have not visited to all those, I mean, nook and corner of this country. So we really appreciate him very much. And I wish him a very good health for all the coming years. So today, I'm going to talk on congruent numbers and their generalizations. And this is joint work with Shamik Das, my PhD student. And actually, he's now a postdoctoral fellow at HRI. Okay, so the outline of my talk will be like this. I mean, this is my layout. So first I will talk, introduce this topic. And of course, congruent numbers are familiar to, I mean, it needs no introduction as such. And only people who are students who have not seen it before, only for them, this will be relevant, I would say. Then secondly, I'll talk about some construction of non-congruent numbers by complete two descent. And next, I'll talk about such construction using Monsky matrices. And then I'll talk about a generalization of congruent numbers known as theta congruent numbers. And then I'll conclude with the references. So let me start with the introduction. So as we know, what is a congruent number? It's a natural number which appears as the area of a right triangle with rational sides. So in other words, we have a right triangle with C as hypotenuse and A, B are the other two sides, such that they give us the area N. And what is the congruent number problem? It's a very classical problem. It is to determine whether a given natural number is congruent or not. And the complete solution is still elusive. Okay, so there's no concrete answer to this yet. And that's why actually people have been interested in constructing families of congruent numbers or non-congruent numbers, because the complete answer is not known. But of course, I'll mention all the significant results in this problem. Okay. Of course, these first few examples are very easy to observe, that we all know that this Pythagorean triplet 3, 4, 5, they will give 6 as congruent number. And it was Fibonacci who showed that 7 is not a congruent number. And he conjectured that seven is a congruent number, but one is not a congruent number. But he did not prove it. The proof is due to Fermat. And Fermat used this famous method of infinite descent, because he showed that if one is a congruent number, then there will be a right triangle with integer sides with a perfect square as the area. And then if such a triangle is there, then you can construct a smaller triangle and smaller, you can keep going smaller, constructing smaller and smaller triangle with perfect square as area, which cannot happen in integers. So that's how it works. And of course, it is equivalent to Fermat's last theorem for the exponent 4. That x4 plus y4 equal to z4 has no solution. It's like equivalent to the statement that 1 is not a congruent number. And of course, we can scale the triangle. So we can remove the square factors. So it's enough to consider the congruent number problem for square free natural numbers. Okay. If 5 is congruent, of course, 20 will also be congruent. It's quite obvious. Vice versa. And the smallest congruent number is 5. And for example, one can explicitly see from this right triangle, and it is one of the infinitely many such triangles, that it's a congruent number. Okay, so the study of congruent number leads to elliptic curves. So how it is connected to elliptic curve, that's I'm going to mention now. Suppose we have such triplet A, B, C, such that A square plus B square is C square and is half times AB, okay? Then if we take X to be C square by 4, then we consider this arithmetic progression, X minus N, X and X plus N. They are rational squares, okay? Because of so these are rational squares. And it is in this formulation that Fibonacci considered this congruent number problem in his book of squares in the 13th century. And even before that, it was mentioned in an Arab manuscript of 10th century. Okay, so this congruent number problem goes back 1,000 years at least. Okay. But how is it connected to the elliptic curve, to an elliptic curve? So if we make a substitution, if we let x is c square by 4 and y is c times b square minus a square by 8, we find that this point x and y, x comma y, it's a rational point on the elliptic curve. Okay, that curve is y square equal to x cube minus n square x. Okay, and this elliptic curve is referred to as the congruent number elliptic curve. Okay. So if we start with such a rational right triangle of area n, we get a point on this elliptic curve. And conversely, if we have a point on this elliptic curve with y coordinate non-zero, then we can construct a right triangle with rational sides of area n. Okay. So the question whether n is congruent or not is equivalent to finding a rational point on this elliptic curve with y coordinate non-zero. Okay. So what are these points which y coordinate zero? Okay. So for that, we have this well-known theorem, Mordell-Weil theorem for elliptic curves, which says that the points on an elliptic curve, they form an abelian group, finitely generated abelian group. And there is a coordinate tangent method. Like if we want to add two points, there's a way to construct it using chords and tangents. Okay. And this Mordell-Weil theorem says that this group is finitely generated. So there's a finite part which we denote by U and Q tors, and there will be a free part which we denote by Z, Rn copies of Z. And this Rn is known as the rank of the Mordell-Weil group. Okay. And for this congruent number elliptic curve, this torsion part is very easy to determine. First of all, this torsion part is actually can be injected into points of the elliptic curve over finite fields of good reduction. Okay. So there's a standard theory of elliptic curves that whenever we have a prime of good reduction. In other words, even after reducing mod p, we get a non-singular curve. Then we call it a prime of good reduction, and distortion points embed into this EFP. And secondly, for primes which are congruent to 3 mod 4, it's very easy to see that number of points on the elliptic curve is p plus 1. It essentially comes from the fact that minus 1 is not a square when p is 3 mod 4. A mod p is not a square. So it essentially comes from that. So one can see that the torsion points are only 4. And those are given by this, where y coordinate, okay, sorry, there's a typo here, it should be plus minus n comma 0. I want, so it's like the y coordinate is 0. So I just wanted to, sorry for this typo, that torsion points are precisely those where y coordinate is 0. So in other words, this criteria we get that a natural number n is congruent if and only if enq has positive rank, or in other words, a point of infinite order. Okay. So that is starting point of many results involving congruent numbers. And there's a famous conjecture which also predicts which numbers should be congruent. Okay. So it is the Hesse-Weil L function of the elliptic, this conjecture concerns the Hesse-Weil L function of the elliptic curve. This L function is nothing but can be expressed as an Euler product. And it has like analytic continuation and functional equation. And most importantly, it has a Taylor expansion at s equal to 1, which you can write like this. And this term, this first non-vanishing term, this is known as the analytic rank. It is the order of vanishing of the L function at s equal to 1. And this BSD conjecture predicts that this algebraic rank is equal to the analytic rank. In other words, k should also be the rank of the elliptic curve. In other words, if this order of vanishing is at least 1, then the elliptic curve will have infinitely many points over rationals. In other words, it will give us congruent numbers. Okay, and in fact, for the congruent number equation, we just need a weaker form. We don't need like algebraic rank and analytic rank to be exactly equal. We just need that if EQ is infinite, then the L function should vanish. That is enough from the point of congruent numbers. Okay. And that's why we expect numbers of the form 8k plus 5, 8k plus 6, and 8k plus 7 to be congruent, because their L function vanishes at s equal to 1. Okay. So they should be congruent. Okay. And there's a famous theorem of Coates and Wiles that is also relevant here, that we say that an elliptic curve has complex multiplication if it has endomorphisms other than multiplication by integers. Because the rational points on an elliptic curve, we can always multiply by integers, but sometimes we have more endomorphisms. Then we say that it has complex multiplication. And this congruent number elliptic curve has complex multiplication by the ring of integers of the Gaussian field, okay, like this. Okay. And for this, we have a result, the theorem of Coates and Wiles, that if E is an elliptic curve with complex multiplication by the ring of integers of an imaginary quadratic field, and if he has a point of infinite order, then the L function vanishes. Okay. In particular, what you can say is that if n is a congruent number, then the L function vanishes at 1. Okay. Using this, we have this one of these most famous results. It's known as Tunnell's criteria for congruent numbers. Okay. So how does it work? That suppose we have a natural number n, it's enough to consider square free natural numbers. So let's consider these forms like 2x square plus y square plus 32z square. And how many ways n can be written like that? And similarly, Suppose bn is the number of ways we can write n as 2x square plus y square plus hz square. And cn, this is the number of ways you can write n as hx square plus 2y square plus 64z square. And dn is the number of ways you can write n as hx square plus 2y square plus 16z square. Then Tanel showed that if n is an odd number, square free odd number, then n is congruent, will imply that bn is twice an. Okay. And similarly, if n is even, then for a congruent number n, dn should be twice cn. That is the unconditional part of this criteria. So this is like a necessary condition for n being congruent. But the converse also holds if we assume a weaker form of the BSD conjecture. In the sense that if the L function vanishes, then there should be a point of infinite order. If that holds, then this can be also a sufficient condition for n being congruent. And this is very useful. For example, we can immediately see that 1, 2, 3, they are non-congruent because the number of ways we can write 3 as 2x square plus y square plus 32z square is same as the number of ways you can write it as 2x square plus y square plus 8z square. So actually, an turns out to be bn, so 3 should not be congruent. Similarly, we expect that anything congruent to 5 should be congruent. Why is that? Because anything congruent to 5 cannot be expressed as 8x square plus 2y square plus 64z square. Okay. Oh, sorry, 2x square plus y square plus 32z square. Okay. So anything congruent to 5, we cannot write it as, like, an will be 0 in that case, and bn will also be 0. Okay. So since so it should be congruent. Okay, but it requires this unconditional part of the BSD, unproven BSD conjecture. Okay, but and there are some, these are well-known families, like classically well-known families. Like, let's say Pj is a prime of the form 8k plus j, where j can be 1, 3, 5, or 7. And it was Higner who first showed that we can construct a point of infinite order on the elliptic curve Enq, where n is twice that prime. So we can say that twice a prime of the 3 mod 8 is congruent. Like it says, 6 should be congruent. And okay. So that is Higner's significant result. And then Monsky extended this to include several other numbers. Okay, so he showed that any prime congruent to 5 or 7, or twice a congruent prime congruent to 7 mod 8, etc. All these, he showed that these are congruent numbers. And of course, there are a few other cases, but then Legendre symbol also comes into play. That if we have some other factors, then the Legendre symbol between them also enters into the picture. That is also needed. Okay. And of course, this most recent significant result is due to Tian, who extended Higner's method to obtain infinite families of congruent numbers with arbitrarily many prime factors. Because previously we had like 2-3 prime factors like that. Okay. But it has Tian's method showed how to do it for with infinitely many prime factors. And on the other hand, there are also construction for non-congruent families. And this is one is classical, like if we have a prime congruent to 3 mod 8, then primes of the form 8k plus 3 are non-congruent. So these are some of the well-known families. Okay, so as I said, since the congruent number problem is not completely resolved and people try to obtain families which are either congruent or non-congruent, and in some sense, like finding non-congruent families are easier than finding congruent families, because to find congruent families, one needs to construct points of infinite order on an elliptic curve, which is more difficult, so to speak, compared to ruling out existence of such points. Okay. So Lagrange and Cerf, they constructed square-free non-congruent numbers with at most 4 prime factors. Then it was ISCRA who did it, which arbitrarily many prime factors of the form 8k plus 3. Okay. So what we have done, Shamik and I, so that we have generalized, I mean, we have extended this approach to include primes, product of pairs of primes. Okay. So this is, we group similar families. So I'm just mentioning one here that suppose t is any positive integer and suppose p1, p2 up to pt and q1, q2 up to qt are distinct primes, so that all these pairs are either equivalent to 1, 3 or 5, 7, mod 8. Okay. And we need certain Legendre simple conditions among these prime factors. Okay. And if we have that, then we can show that this their product is a non-congruent number. So this just gives us new families. Okay. So for each T, we have like such families. Okay. And how does it work? I'll just give a brief sketch that we use complete two descent. So, and we can work with some generality. Let's consider an elliptic curve E over a number field K. And suppose it has Weierstrass equation of this form, where this E1, E2, and E3, they belong to K. And then we have to consider this set of bad primes. Okay, so it's like where we include all these Archimedean places and places dividing two, and where E has bad reduction. And then we have to consider a set KS2 in the multiplicative non-squares in K, such that the valuation at those primes other than these bad primes is divisible by 2. Okay, this is standard this is this set. And then what is complete 2 descent? You can find it in Silverman's book also. That there is an injective map from this model well quotient to this product of KS2 itself. And this map can be explicitly given like this. Okay. So, and we have some information which elements of the right hand side appears as the image of this quotient of the model well group under this two descent map. Okay. For that, we have a system of equations like b1 z1 square minus b2 z2 square should be e2 minus e1, and b1 z1 square minus b1 b2 z3 square is e3 minus e1. They should have a solution in k star times k star times k. Okay. So what we need to do is to show that something is non-congruent, some elliptic curve is non-congruent, we have to rule out solutions for this type of equations. So that's what we have to do. And okay, in our case of congruent number elliptic curve, it simplifies to these equations. Okay, because rather than rational solutions, we convert it to integral equations. And in these integral equations, what we need to do is rule out solutions for the types of M that we have considered. Okay. And so that's where actually these Legendre symbols come into play, that we rule out solutions modulo certain primes. And yeah, so that's what we extend ISCRA's argument to rule out these solutions, and then we obtain these families. Okay, that is a rough sketch. And of course, it is easy to see that this gives us infinitely many examples, okay, that these families are infinite, okay. That for each T, such pairs, we can find infinitely many of them. And this is essentially a consequence of Dirichlet's theorem on prime set arithmetic progression together with Chinese remainder theorem and induction. So that's an easy proof. So just to check that, we have indeed infinitely many examples. And we can easily find some examples to demonstrate this. Okay. And second way of construction is using Bonsky matrices. Okay. So what do these matrices do? They are useful in computing the two Selmer rank And the two-cellular rank is a bound for the model wheel rank. Okay, because we know that if this model wheel rank is, if you can show it to be zero, then the number will be non-congruent. And rather than showing the model wheel rank to be zero, we try to show that two-cellular rank itself is zero, because two-cellular rank gives an upper bound for the model wheel rank. And the Smonsky matrices, they bound actually this, they give you a formula for this two-cellular rank. Okay. And using these matrices, several other authors have constructed non-congruent families like Reynolds, Spearman, Young, or Cheng and Guo. Okay. And so we proved results like this. So we're just mentioning one here, that now we can consider triplets of primes satisfying certain congruence conditions modulo 8 and some Legendre symbol conditions. Okay, and then here it's even number, we can show that it's non-congruent. Okay, so let us briefly give some idea how this Monsky matrix argument works. Okay, so for that we just briefly recall the two-cellular group. So to define two-cellular group, we need to go back to this fundamental sequence, like multiplication by two map on the points on the elliptic curve. And we have this exact sequence. And then one has to take this Galois cohomology and get a short exact sequence like this, where from the quotient of the model wheel group to the first cohomology group, we have this Kumar map, just like the Kumar map in cyclotomic field case. It's like, it's similar. But how does it work? That if we have a Galois map, then we can take Q sigma minus Q, where 2 times Q should be P. Okay, so there's a typo here. 2 times Q should be P, not 2P should be Q, but 2Q should be P. I'm sorry for that. Okay. Anyways, but it's very well known. So this is the Kumar map. And then we also have, locally also we have these local Kumar maps. Okay, for each place V of K, we have a local Kumar map as well. And this local absolute Galois group, we know is like the decomposition subgroup of the Galois group. So we have a commutative diagram like this, that we have the global sequence and then we have the local sequence at each place. And since this local Galois group is a subgroup of the global Galois group, we have the restriction maps, vertical restriction maps. And what is the Selmer group? It is the kernel from this term to this term. Okay, so this the second term on the first sequence, the last term on the second sequence. Okay, so this is the Selmer group. And also we have the Shapiravi state group, which is like the kernel of the vertical map here. Okay, or two part of it we are defining. So it's like the Shapiravi state group. And importantly, most importantly for us, we have this short exact sequence, that this quotient of the model wheel group is embedded in this two-cellular group. So that's where actually we get a bound for this quotient. Okay. So if we have some control over the two-cellular group, then we have some control over this model group. Okay. And anyway, we are only interested in the congruent number elliptic curve over Q. So in our case, what we have is that this quotient is bounded by number of elements in the Selmer group. And one can show that this is actually bounded by this number. Okay. So I'm leaving out these details, but these are can be found in Silverman as well. Okay. And in our case, we know that this ENQ, we know what it looks like. So we have this model with quotient as 2 to the power 2 plus Rn. Okay. And that's why we denote the number of elements in the two-cellular group as 2 to the power 2 plus Sn. And this Sn is referred to as two-cellular rank. Okay. And it's clear that Rn is bounded above by Sn. And so we can show that N is non-congruent provided Sn can be shown to be zero. And that Monsky matrix gives us a formula for computing Sn. So how do we define the Monsky matrix? So maybe just briefly mention that. Suppose we have a square-free number. I'm just doing it for the odd case, but that similarly it can be done for the even one as well. Okay, so we have QS2, which is like will be generated by these primes and minus one, and then these equations that we had in the two descent, we can reformulate like this. And then Heath Brown has explained, I mean, in his paper in Invention is that that what is Rn? It is like the that is the number of systems with non-trivial integer solutions. And what is Sn? It is the number of this system of equations which have locally, which are locally solvable everywhere. Okay. So Sn is for this local solution. So what Monsky matrices will do is that it will count this Sn. Okay. And so the Monsky matrix is formed like this. And so I'm just mentioning the details, but I'll probably just quickly go through it, that we have this matrix with entries which are basically have to do with these Legendre symbols, okay? And they are coming from the local solvability conditions. So these entries, they are basically keeping track of these local solvability conditions for these two equations, for these equations, okay? And this is the formula that is useful to us. That is 2-Selmer rank is 2m minus rank F2 of this Monsky matrix when n is odd. And similarly, we have a Monsky matrix when n is even as well. Okay, so that reduces our task to computation of rank. If we can show that, to show that Sn is zero, we just have to show that this Monsky matrix is invertible. Okay, so and that's what we do with some Suhr's decomposition lemma, etc. So, but that's basically linear algebra tools one can apply and show that this matrix is invertible, and that gives the vanishing of the 2-Selmer rank and gives us non-congruent families. So finally, I'll talk about this generalization of congruent numbers known as theta congruent numbers. Okay. So the congruent number problem has been studied for other number fields as well. So at least, I mean, it dates back to Tada, which considered triangles with sides in real quadratic fields, because traditionally it was like rational right triangles, but now we allow sides to take values in real quadratic or other number fields. Okay, and the question is whether just triangle can occur from torsion points, because the congruent number elliptic curve over rational numbers, it has only two torsion points with y coordinate zero. But if it has other torsion points, then there's a possibility that n appears as the congruent number over those number fields from a torsion point on the curve. And that would mean that there will not be infinitely many triangles, but only finitely many triangles of sides in that number field and n as area. Okay, so. But what Jetriak did, he showed that it can happen, it cannot happen for torsion points, that it requires actually a point of infinite order for n to be congruent over a number field, provided there are certain conditions on the number field, that real number field should be of odd degree or of degree twice a prime. And these square root of 2, square root of 3, and square root of 5 should not belong to that field. And under these conditions, that if n is congruent over a number field, it has to come from a point of infinite order. Okay. And how does this proof work? It actually uses results on the torsion subgroup of elliptic curves with complex multiplication over number fields. Because these elliptic curves have complex multiplication, so the torsion structure is well understood, not just over Q, but over other number fields as well, due to work of Silverberg and Prasad and Yogananda. So that's how this result is obtained. Okay. And then what are theta congruent numbers? So basically, so we will also do similar study, but for theta congruent numbers. So this is for classical congruent numbers. So we do similar study for theta congruent numbers. So we'll soon define what are theta congruent numbers. So basically, our question would be whether theta congruent numbers over real number fields necessarily appear from points of infinite order, or whether they can appear from torsion points. In other words, whether there are infinitely many triangles corresponding to such a congruent number or not. So what is a theta congruent number? Of course, like this classical congruent number, we insist that the triangle is right triangle triangle. But for theta congruent number, we allow any triangle with rational cosine. Okay, so this is introduced by Fujiwara and Tan separately or independently. So we allow triangles with rational cosine, and we consider triangles. Originally, it was considered with sides in rational numbers only. That U, V, W, they still belong to rational numbers with angle theta between the sides U and V. And we say that N is congruent if, or theta congruent, if the area can be expressed like N alpha theta, where alpha theta is the square root of R square minus S square. Okay. That is basically coming from the sine theta, that we cannot get rid of this irrational part. Okay. So in other words, N is a theta congruent number if we have this like W square is U square plus V square minus 2UV cos theta, and then area is like 2RN is UV. Okay. So this is a generalization. Of course, if we take theta to be pi by 2, it matches with the classical congruent numbers. Like if S is 0, then we are basically talking about classical congruent numbers. Okay. And okay, so after theta equal to pi by 2, there are some natural cosines that one can consider, pi by 3 or 2 pi by 3. And then Fujiwara did that. So he showed that these primes, which are congruent to 5, 7, or 19 mod 24, they are not pi by 3 congruent. And Khan also showed that if a prime of the form 7, 11, or 13 mod 8, 13 mod 24, they are not 2 pi by 3 congruent. Okay. And on the other hand, if a prime is 23 mod 24, then those primes are pi by 3 as well as 2 pi by 3 congruent. And there are similar results like Jiral, Lalin, and Nair, or Mokrani. They have also constructed several other families, and some of them used Monsky matrices also. Like there's a version of Monsky matrix argument to deal with this pi by 3 and 2 pi by 3 congruent numbers as well. Okay. And just like this classical congruent number, there is also theta congruent number elliptic curve, which we can write like this. And so again, like if a number is theta congruent, then that this elliptic, it leads to a rational point on this elliptic curve. So essentially, what Fujiwara shown is that a positive integer is theta congruent if and only if this congruent number, theta congruent number elliptic curve, has a point of order greater than 2. It can be a point of infinite order, or it can be like order other than 2. And he showed that if n is not 1, 2, 3, or 6, then and is theta congruent if and only if E and theta is positive rank. Okay. So in other words, it doesn't come from torsion points. Okay. So essentially what we are going to do, we will consider this question for number fields, real number fields. So this is Fujiwara's result for rational numbers. So we just want an analog for number fields. That if a number N is theta congruent over a number field, then it is not actually coming from torsion point, but it is coming from points of infinite order. So that is the kind of criteria that we are looking for. But then we have to put some conditions on the degree of the number field. Okay, just like the result for classical congruent numbers. Okay. which were generalized to other number fields similarly. So what you're going to do, we consider theta congruent numbers over a real number field, and we allow triangles to have sides in that number field. And as I said, we are interested in proving an analog of Fujiwara's criteria for such number fields. And in particular, whether existence of one such triangle implies existence of infinitely many such triangles that correspond to N. And in terms of the theta congruent number elliptic curve, the question is whether this N is associated with a non-torsion point or not. Okay. So essentially, what we have to do is to look at the torsion structure of this elliptic curve, this theta congruent number elliptic curve. And this task would have been simpler if this curve had complex multiplication. Because if the elliptic curve has complex multiplication, then its torsion structure is better understood, as I said, due to work of Silverberg and Yogananda and Prasad. But unfortunately, this curve is non-CM, which we can show. I mean, except of course in the classical case where theta is pi by 2. So if we rule out theta equal to pi by 2, this curves do not have complex multiplication. And we can show this easily by considering the Zeign invariant, because this Zeign invariant we know explicitly. And we also know that if an elliptic curve has complex multiplication, if an elliptic curve over Q has complex multiplication, then its Zeign invariant has only 13 possibilities. They're explicitly known 13 integers. Okay. And what are those 13 integers? They are values of this modular function at tau, just that z tau is a PID. Okay. So there are only 13 values that we have to check, and we can rule that out. Okay. So we just rule that out, that this curve doesn't have complex multiplication. So we have to rely on some other results basically to look into its torsion structure. And okay, but for multi-quadratic fields, it is somewhat easier that one can directly try this, that for real multi-quadratic fields. But we need two conditions, that this N and NMI, their square free part, should not divide 6. Okay. It has something to do with Fujiwara's result that we could not consider N equal to 1, 2, 3 or 6. So it has something to do with that. And then we need a second condition. Okay. So these conditions are needed. So we cannot consider all angles, all rational cosines, but actually only those where this is not a square. Okay. Then we can say that N is theta congruent over this multi-quadratic field if and only if this has a point of infinite order. Okay. And how do we do that? Just I'm mentioning the key steps, that with the first condition, we show that this is a two group. That and with the second condition, we rule out four torsion points. Okay. So first we show that it's a two group, and then we rule out four torsion points. So essentially we are left with two torsion points, and we know that two torsion points have y coordinate zero. So if n is theta congruent, then we'd have a point of infinite order. Okay. And similarly, we can consider real cubic fields, but again we are not able to take into account all rational cosines, but we do have certain conditions on the rational cosines, that this R by S, if cos theta is R by S, then we put some conditions on R and S modulo 5. Okay, so we are not considering all angles. Then we can easily show that N is a theta congruent number, if and only if this congruent theta congruent number elliptic curve has a point of infinite order. And how do we do that? We consider this set phi q dz. What is that? This is taking this is like set of all possible torsions of an elliptic curve defined over q, such that its torsion structure over q is z, and the degree of k over q is d. Okay. So z is given. So in our case, we know the torsion structure over Q, and if we insist on the degree being 3, then there are only very few possibilities. In other words, in our case, we just have to rule out tree torsion. In our case, for cubic fields, we just need to rule out tree torsion because of his result due to Gonzalez and Jimenez. Gonzalez, Jimenez, and others, his collaborators. That it, for real cubic fields, it boils down to ruling out tree torsion. And for real fields of degree co-prime to 6, also it is relatively easier to prove this result. Okay. But of course, we have this unfortunate condition that degree should not be divisible by 55. Even when the degree is co-prime to 6, we need an additional condition in a special case. Okay. But with that, we can actually say that n is theta congruent if and only if there is a point of infinite order. Then why is it so? Because when the degree is co-prime to 6, there is a there are certain results known for the torsion part. Okay. So that is due to this result of Gonzalez, Jimenez, and Nyman. That if an elliptic curve E over Q and K over Q is a number field of degree D, and the smallest prime divisor of D is at least B, then we have the possibilities of the torsion point or the PC loop subgroup of the torsion points that has certain restrictions. Okay. So since we are mostly concerned with this part 3, so let me just focus on this. Let's see what it means. That when our when the primes 2 or 3 do not divide the degree, then P torsion over K and P torsion over Q, they are same except for these 3 primes, 5, 7, and 11. In other words, our task is to rule out 5 torsion, 7 torsion, and 11 torsion. Okay. So essentially, our task is cut out. Like we have to just rule out torsion of order 5, 7, and 11. And it is for this ruling out torsion, 11 torsion points, that we have this unfortunate condition that 55 does not divide the degree of the number field. Okay. So, and for real sextic field also, we can prove the same thing, but this result is conditional because the result on the torsion is still conjectural. Okay, that when the number field has degree 6, that we have a conjectural result for the 6th torsion, for the torsion of the elliptic curve. And using that, we can, the same argument will work or similar arguments will work, but this result that we rely on, it is still conjectural. So the result for real sextic field is still conjectural. And of course, it will be interesting to do this for in general, okay, for number fields of any degree, or in fact, maybe to start with number fields of degree which are co-prime to 2 or odd degree, because even if it is odd degree, we have to rule out these many, we have to consider only these many cases, okay? Still, we have a finite list, only these few primes, we have to look at their torsion, okay? When the number field has odd degree. So maybe that might be a starting point to consider whether we have this similar result for those number fields of that those degrees. Okay. So yeah. So maybe I'll conclude here. These are the references. That of course this is Zeigner's famous work where he constructed points of infinite order for primes, twice primes of two times primes which are congruent 3 mod 8, and this is Tunnell's criteria, which is one of the most famous results concerning congruent numbers, where he used modular forms of with 3/2. And he related vanishing of the L function to some coefficients of the modular form. And then Monsky will generalize the Zeigner's results for several other natural numbers. Okay. And it is in Hildebrand's paper that Monsky matrices were introduced in the appendix. Okay. So we have used. And of course, Tian's is the most remarkable result in recent years, constructing congruent numbers with arbitrarily many prime factors. And this is the Skrass paper. Paper that we extended his work in the first part of the presentation. Okay. And these are Fuzier and Khan who introduced theta congruent numbers. Okay. And yeah, these are the results on the torsion point of the elliptic curve that we have used. Okay, so yeah, thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Anupamda. I request everybody to thank the speaker. And if there are questions from seminar hall, please.
Okay, so I have a question. This is a sort of a soft question. Is that so? You in the early part of your talk, you were talking about some elliptic curves which are which naturally come up from congruent numbers and theta congruent numbers, etc. So, do we know anything about the modular forms that come up from there? So, because I am asking this because to answer this to answer the problem of a number being congruent or not, it is intimately connected to the vanishing of the L function at the point one, right? Yeah. So if we can connect it to a modular form, will that help us in solving that problem in some sense? So
I think like Tanil's work is I think is related to your question, like because he relates the L value to certain coefficients of the modular form. And yeah, so that way the modular problems are very much involved. And of course, you can look at, maybe I referred at the end, like Skoblitz's book, probably you can, because everything is beautifully explained. I think it is, this whole book actually explains Tanil's criteria for congruent numbers. And also the modular problems of half integral weights that is involved there. So yeah.
No, sir. So I was actually interested if we know the actual modular form given an elliptic curve of that form. So, like, do we know the level and do we know the weight of where exactly where that is sitting?
Okay. So at least in Tanil's criteria, that it is weight 3/2, and yeah, I mean, yeah, it is involved with some theta series and all. Yeah. So. That's all I can say actually.
Yeah, Anupam, I have some queries. Like, first one is that the generalization what you are doing for theta congruent numbers.
Yeah.
So I know that over Q, so you are going for totally real fields. So yeah. Is there any way to extend it to imaginary quadratic, for example?
Yeah, because we are thinking of triangles and the sides, we expect that to be real number. I mean, that's why we're actually sticking to real numbers, right?
Yeah, I mean, some kind of using some norm or some such thing. I don't know.
Yeah, that I have not considered actually.
I've not come across such generalization. And then what kind of, in your result for the generalized theta congruent numbers, the field that you are choosing,
yeah.
I mean, the field that is finally comes out, it's like the square root, say 2 power something. Or
These are like we are avoiding. So our general result actually avoids the prime factors 2 and 3. So basically, as long as the degree is not divisible by 2 and 3, we have certain results. And it is because we know more about the torsion structure of the concerned elliptic curve when the number fields, the degree of the number field is not divisible by 2 and 3. That is because of Neumann and Gonzalez-Jimenez result. That is our, because that's what we are exploiting. But
yes. So that's the only restriction.
Yeah, because if we want to include, for example, I think it is still possible to include the prime 3 because, as I said, because if we include the prime 3 still, we just have to rule out certain torsions, which is, I mean, the list is not too long. But I suppose that if we include 2, then I mean, 2 and other factors, of course. If we have only multi-quadratic fields, then we can get it. But yeah,
multi-quadratic.
But yeah, I think from this fourth condition can still be exploited to extend the region.
Yeah, I was just thinking that, you know, multi-quadratic, when you would take that 2 power, something like that, using, you know, put that Galois condition, like the constructible numbers or some such things. So will it be?
It will certainly be worth considering. Like,
putting the Galois condition, will it be possible to consider?
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, maybe that will lead to certain things. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, it's very interesting. Thanks a lot, Anupam.
Thank you.
Are there any questions from online audience? Okay, I think Professor Michel Waldschmidt has a question. Yes, sir, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, Anupam. Very interesting. You mentioned the work of Hisraun on the Tousselmer rank.
Yes.
Are there some statistics? Does it happen often that RN and SN are not equal?
Okay, basically, like they should be equal. They should be, I think, equal most of the time. Yeah, I mean, at least they have the same parity. I mean, like there's a Selmer conjecture that they have the same parity. Yeah, so but yeah, not necessarily equal, but they have same parity. But if we allow this, if we consider two infinity Selmer groups, if we take the limit in the direct limit of these two Selmer groups, and then of course, because of finiteness of the separate state group, that this model will rank and the Selmer rank should be same. But yeah, but for the two Selmer rank itself, I think it's just the parity should be equal.
Okay,
that's my understanding. Yeah, and it's very, thank you for attending this talk. It's really a privilege that you were.
So, any other questions? Anupam, at the very
beginning, one, and then you can take over. In that context of Michelle's question, so have people studied this, how often they are not equal? I mean, like, is there any criteria kind of thing that, you know, most often they are equal, but is there any like almost always or some such study whether people have done it that RN and SN?
I mean that if we consider the two infinity Selmer group or any p infinity Selmer group, then certainly this model will rank and that should be equal because conjecturally this separable state group is finite, so they should be equal.
Yeah, okay,
but,
yeah.
But for the two Selmer rank, I mean, I think as far as I know, it's like the parity. In the Hildebrand's paper also it is mentioned that it parity should be same.
Okay.
Yeah, Anupamda, there was one of the early slides, one condition about this congruent numbers or number field, that the number field K should not have root 2, root 3, root 5.
Yeah. So I think it has to do it probably, I mean, I do not exactly recall now, but it has to do it probably the study of the torsion structure of the classical congruent number elliptic curve over number fields. I think because these conditions, I think they have to do with this result of Silverberg. And, I mean, that's my guess now because I do not distinctly recall what it was, but.
Okay. Maybe these prime factors appear there, maybe.
Yeah.
Thank you, Anupamda. So once again, let's thank the speaker.
Thank you. Thank you all for your attention.
And next talk will be at 11:50 Indian Standard Time. That means after 20 minutes. So KSOM people have a tea break now.